Everyone, today we'll start with the advancements in periodontics. So this will be dealt under two parts. Under the first part, we'll talk about platelet-rich fibrin, lasers, and microsurgery. So this topic will be dealt in a way that you will be able to attempt an answer, a short answer. Okay, so just a brief idea about each topic is given. Okay, so first we'll start with platelet-rich fibrin. So what is platelet-rich fibrin? It is also called as PRF. Okay, so PRF is platelet-rich fibrin. So it is a fibrin matrix in which there are platelet cytokines, growth factors, and cells. So there is a fibrin meshwork. And on this, we have different growth factors, cells, and platelet cytokines. So all these cells, growth factors, everything, they are trapped in a fibrin matrix and they are released after a certain time. So we will see the uses later. So, but in case of regeneration, in case of osseous defects, or in case of extraction sockets, so whenever we place this PRF, all these growth factors and all will be released after a certain time. So they can be used as a resorbable membrane. We can use it for the purpose of guided tissue regeneration also. So they act as a resorbable membrane. So basically, this PRF is a concentrate of growth factors that promotes the wound healing and regeneration. So it will accelerate the wound healing. It will help in the wound healing and also in the regeneration process. So now, what is this PRF containing? It's a combination of host cells. What are the host cells that are seen in PRF? Platelets, leukocytes, red blood cells, macrophages, granulocytes. All these cells are different cell types are seen in the PRF. And these cell types are present in the matrix, this fibrin matrix. Okay, so a three-dimensional fibrin matrix is present and there are growth factors. So the different growth factors that are seen in PRF are the platelet-derived growth factor, vascular endothelial growth factor, insulin growth factor, epidermal growth factor, TGF-beta, transforming growth factor beta, bone morphogenic proteins. Okay, so in the PRF, we are having a fibrin matrix, a three-dimensional fibrin matrix, and we have different cell types, that is the platelets, leukocytes, and RBCs. And we have bioactive molecules, that is the growth factors, different growth factors are present. So all these together act synergistically and they will enhance the wound healing and regeneration. Okay. So in order to accelerate the wound healing, for the purpose of wound healing, we can use different biomaterials. So these biomaterials can be natural, or they can be chemical. That means they can be fabricated artificially. So PRF is a natural product. So with the help of these foreign products, there might be foreign body reaction. Okay. So biomaterials can be naturally synthesized or they can be artificially synthesized. Okay. Usually in case of these foreign materials, we usually see a foreign body reaction. We may see a foreign body reaction. Whereas PRF is naturally prepared. So this PRF was first developed in France by Joseph Chokran. You need to remember this name. Chokran was the person who introduced the PRF concept. So these PRF is one of the platelet concentrates. So in platelet concentrates, we have platelet-rich fibrin, platelet-rich plasma, platelet-poor plasma. So these are different kinds of platelet concentrates. So today our topic of discussion is platelet-rich fibrin. Okay, so this platelet-rich fibrin, usually all the platelet concentrates, they improve the wound healing. By how are they improving the wound healing? They are facilitating the recruitment of the cells that are important for the healing. They are helping the proliferation of the cells. They are helping in the maturation of the cells that are participating in the regeneration. So by recruiting the cells, proliferation and maturation of the cells, they are helping in improvement of the wound healing. So now how do we prepare this PRF? Okay, so first, blood is collected from the patient. So blood is taken from the patient in glass tubes. Okay, in glass tubes. So why glass tubes? Is this glass tubes will help in the coagulation cascade. Okay, they play, once the blood contacts the glass tubes, they will help in improve. They will help in the coagulation cascade. Okay, so after the blood is collected, we are placing it in a centrifuge machine. Okay. We are placing it in a centrifuge machine. So there will be specific time, specific pressure, force that has to be used, centrifugation force that has to be used. After that, we'll see this kind of picture in the glass tube. So we have the top layer, that is a platelet poor plasma, that is a acellular plasma. And we have fibrin clot, which is the PRF. So this fibrin clot is having all the cells and the growth factors in it. And the down layer, the bottom layer, we have the red blood cells. Okay, so there are three layers. So after centrifugation, this will appear like this. Okay, so in the glass tube, we'll see we have placed the blood, right? Now the blood has turned into these three layers. So the top layer is the platelet poor plasma. So this should be eliminated. This should be cut off. And we need this layer, right? This fibrin clot we need. And so we will cut this at the junction of this RBC and the fibrin clot. So some layer of RBC will also appear in the PRF. Okay, so we'll cut this part. Okay, and we'll use it for, like, depending on the depending on the area that we are using, whether it is extraction socket or in case of osseous defect. So wherever we are using, we will use this part. Okay, this part will cut off and use it. Okay, so here you need to understand an important concept, that is about the force that we are using. Okay, so whatever technique that Chaukran has given uses a force of 708 grams. Okay, so with these high force, the fibrin network that is created is dense. So a very solid network of fibrin is created. And in that, since this network is solid, the interfibrillar space is very less. Interfibrillar space, that is the space in between this fibrin network, is this meshwork is very less. The space is very less. So since the space is very less, there will be less amount of cells that get trapped into this fibrin matrix. So PRF is nothing but the fibrin matrix in which there are different kinds of cells that are getting trapped, right? So since this is a solid structure, in case of the PRF that is prepared by Chaukran with a high centrifugation force, there is solid meshwork into which less amount of cells are getting trapped. Okay, so here you can see this is the PRF that is prepared by the technique given by Chaukran. So here you can see little amount of cells that are dispersed, right? And there are more amount of cells that are present on one end. Okay, so on one end, and this side we do not have, on the distal aspect, we do not have more number of cells. Okay, so later this concept was modified and less amount of centrifugation force was used. That is a low speed centrifugation concept. We are using low speed. So here, this is called as advanced PRF, APRF, wherein here previously it was 708, here only 208. So 208 grams of pressure was only used. Okay, force was used. So with this force, what happened is porous structure of fibrin is created. So fibrin structure is not solid now, it is porous. So there is a lot of interfibrillar space that is present. So it is attracting more cell type. Okay, so it's attracting more amount of leukocytes. So this is APRF. So if you see APRF, there are more amount of cells that are getting dispersed when compared to the regular conventional PRF. So here we have learned two types of PRF. The regular PRF that was given by Chaukran and another one that is the advanced PRF. No need to remember the author here, but remember there is PRF, APRF. And next, here there is another one called as IPRF. Here, still the speed has been reduced. It has been made to 60 grams only. So this IPRF means injectable PRF. So this can be injected directly into the defects. Okay, so the previous PRFs, the types that we have seen are solid. Okay, so they are placed in the form of a membrane. Okay, so after cutting the, from the glass tube, I have shown the center part, right? There is a fibrin clot part. So that we have to cut and we will be using it as a membrane. Whereas injectable PRF, we will be injecting it directly into the defects in the area that we need. So here, the speed is still reduced. So it is having more amount of cells. So as the force is decreasing, as the centrifugation force is decreasing, there will be increase in the inflammatory cells and growth factors. So there are more amount of cells and more amount of growth factors. Okay, so I hope you understand how the PRF is prepared, the concept of PRF. So we have seen the PRF concept that was given by Chaukran. Advanced PRF, APRF, wherein the speed has been reduced. And last one is the injectable PRF, that is the IPRF, where the speed has still been reduced. So all this is a low speed centrifugation concept. So now, where is this PRF used? So this PRF is used in different branches of dentistry, not only in dentistry, in medicine also it is used in different areas. For the healing of diabetic foot ulcers, chronic ulcers also, this PRF is used. So we'll see in dentistry. In endodontics, we can use it for the treatment of open apex cases, in case of pulpotomies, periapical surgeries, and in case of OMFS, we can use it as a filling material in case of bony defects, avulsion sockets, in case of extraction sockets, okay, for the purpose of rich preservation, In case of sinus lifts, when we need bone augmentation, we can use this PRF. In case of periodontics, we can use, this is all combined, okay? So, but just remember that these are the different areas in which the PRF can be used. So for the treatment of intra-bony defects, for the treatment of gingival recession, guided tissue regeneration. So we are using PRF as a membrane here. So again, for grafting the periapical lesions. So for the cultivation of periosteal cells from the bone, we can use this PRF. Now I'll show you two different cases. Okay. So here extraction has been done and here we have placed the PRF as a membrane. So they have placed the PRF as a membrane and sutured. So this is after healing. So now, so extraction socket is a defect, right? The bony defect. So in that we have placed the PRF and we can even augment it with the bone graft also. So we can use the bone graft material as well as PRF. Okay. So after 3 months, you can see good healing and good formation of bone. So later they have placed the implant. So here the PRF has been used in the extraction sockets. So next case report number two is about treating the gingival recession. So here in case of gingival recession, in order to treat the gingival recession, the PRF was used. So here APRF was used in this case report. So here the flap has been elevated, a split thickness flap has been elevated. So this is the PRF that has been obtained after centrifugation. So here you can see the PRF membrane has been placed. So later the flap was approximated, the flap is coronally advanced and suturing has been done. So now you can understand the application of PRF, right? So now we'll talk about laser. So first topic is finished, the PRF is finished. Now we'll talk about lasers. So laser means light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So this is the full form of laser. So we'll talk about the stimulated emission later. So you have to remember light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. There is another word called as maser. Maser means same everything, but M is microwave. Microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So now what is laser? So how is it functioning? So once the laser light is falling onto a tissue. So this light is having some amount of energy, right? So it is functioning by stimulating the emission of light energy from a given medium in a collimated, focused, monochromatic layer of light. So I'll explain you this. So once the laser energy is falling onto a tissue, it is interacting with the tissue. So if this is a tissue, the laser light is falling onto the tissue, it is interacting with this tissue. There are different kinds of interactions. So after interacting with the tissue, there will be the required action. Okay, so this interaction with the tissue results in an action and there will be emission of a collimated light. Collimated means a parallel beam, perfectly parallel beam of light is emitted and it is focused. That means wherever we are projecting, it will be focused into that area only. It is monochromatic. That means there is narrow range of wavelength. Narrow range of wavelength is seen and there is one specific color, monochromatic. There is this one specific color and there is narrow range of wavelength. Okay, so this you have to remember. Laser light is collimated, focused and monochromatic. And there is another term called as coherent. This is also coherent. That means, so if this is the laser beam, so all these waves, the emitted photons will have a constant relationship. This is all constant. Okay, this won't alter. There is a constant relationship in between the time and phase. So just remember that there is all the photons that are emitted will bear a constant phase relationship with each other. So there is a equal relationship between each other. Okay, between all the photons that are emitted. Okay, so next. So I have told that the laser energy is released and it is interacting with the tissue, okay, to produce a required action. So now what is the interaction? So there are four different kinds of interaction that may be seen. The laser, once we are directing the laser beam, it might not interact with the tissue. It might just come and touch the tissue and just leave the tissue. It might just get reflected. So there is no, we don't need this reflection. Okay, we want the laser tissue to interact with the, we want the laser energy, laser beam to interact with the tissue. So in case of reflection, what is happening? The laser beam is just coming and it is just leaving. Okay, so this is reflection. So the laser beam may just come and leave, which is called as reflection. Or it might be absorbing into the tissues. So we need this. We need absorption. So we are targeting the laser beam to a particular tissue. So now the laser beam is touching the tissue and it is getting absorbed. So this, we need absorption. Or the laser beam, the third kind of interaction is scattering. So the laser beam is coming and touching the tissue. So it is getting redirected to different areas. So the whole energy is getting weakened. So it, in absorption, you can see the energy is getting directly transferred to the tissue. Whereas in case of scattering, the energy is getting weakened by getting scattered. Okay. So fourth kind of interaction is transmission. So here, what is happening? We want the interaction here, but the laser beam is passing the superficial layers. It is entering into the deeper tissues and it is getting interacted. It is interacting somewhere, causing unnecessary harm, right? So we do not want reflection. We do not want scattering. We do not want transmission. So we want absorption, right? In case of scattering, what is happening? It is not acting at the required area, but it is acting at, areas that we do not want the laser beam to get interacted, right? So in case of transmission also, we want it to interact somewhere here, but it is interacting into the deeper tissues. In reflection, it is coming and it is leaving. So where is it leaving? It is directing again. It is targeting again another tissue that we don't want. It might be eyes of the operator or patient or assistant, anyone. So reflection, it is not interacting with the tissue. It is going and interacting with something else. Okay, that might be even the eyes of the operator also. That is why whenever we are using laser, we have to use the protective eyeglasses. So these are the four different interactions of the laser with the target tissue. It might be reflecting, absorption, scattering, or transmission. So what do we want? What kind of interaction do we want? We want absorption. Okay. So now let's see the components of the laser. So this laser is having, so first, laser is an external energy source. The external energy source is coming and meeting. So there is an optical cavity that is present. In this optical cavity, we have two mirrors at each end. One is a reflective mirror, one is a transmissive mirror. Just remember that there are two different mirrors that are present. Center, we have an active medium. This active medium can be solid, liquid, or gas. Okay, just remember this. So there is an optical cavity. There are two mirrors at each end. And in the center, we have an active medium that might be solid, liquid, or gas. Okay. So yeah. So I'll explain you an important concept here. So this is the laser tube, right? The optical cavity that is present. So now what is happening is here we are directing the laser beam. Okay. So the laser photons, these are the laser photons. Now inside there will be different atoms. So this empty circles are atoms. Okay. So now what is happening is the photons from the external source, that is this dotted lines, these photons from the external source are interacting with the atoms. They are striking the atoms. Once these photons from the external source are striking the atoms, what is happening? They will amplify. These atoms will amplify. They will double. Okay. Now, this again, these after striking, there is amplification. Okay. So now these atoms will strike another atoms. Again, this atom will amplify. Okay. So by stimulation or from this external source, the atoms are getting amplified. Okay. So this is called a stimulated emission of radiation. Okay. So atoms release more photons again. So after these photons are striking, again, these atoms will amplify. So after the stimulation from an external source, these atoms are getting amplified. This is called as stimulated emission of radiation. That is why in laser, we have the laser amplification of stimulated emission of radiation. So what happens once this whole interaction is taking place? After that, we will have a beam that is emerging. This beam is coherent. This beam is focused. This beam is monochromatic. So this beam will come out of the, this beam will come out from the slit, from the mirror side. Okay, so this beam will come out and now it will interact with the tissue. So we have seen the tissue interaction, right? So this is the functioning of the laser. These are all the different components of the laser, right? Next. So what are the different types of lasers that are used in dentistry? So we have argon laser, diode laser. These wavelengths are very important. Okay, so there are different wavelengths at which the laser, there are different wavelengths. So these lasers will particularly work only in this wavelength. Okay. So usually the common type of lasers that we use are in near infrared region, near infrared. Okay. Yeah. So the different kinds of lasers that are used are argon laser at a wavelength of 488 to 514 nanometer. So this is used in tooth bleaching and advanced curing lights. And diode laser, which is used at a wavelength of 655 to 980 nanometer. So this is used for gingivectomy, oral medicine uses like for cases of aphthous ulcer, biopsies, and even for dentinal desensitizing, second stage implant exposure. So once we place the implant, what happens is we'll suture it off. Okay, after placing the implant, we'll again place the flap back and suture it off. After 3 months, we will call the patient for second stage. At that time, we need to expose the gingival tissue. So for that case, we can use laser. Okay, for example, diode laser or ND-YAG laser, which means neodymium yttrium aluminum garnet laser. Okay, so wavelength for this is 1064 nanometer. Next is erbium chromium YSGG laser or erbium YAG laser or CO2 laser. Okay, so these are the different kinds of laser. Now you need to understand an important concept, that is a photodynamic therapy. So in case of photodynamic therapy, we have a photosensitizer or a photoactive dye. Okay, so now laser light is falling onto the tissue directly, right? In the previous case, what we have learned, the laser light is falling directly onto the tissue. Here, in case of photodynamic therapy, what happens is the light is falling onto the tissue that is treated with photosensitizer or a photoactive dye. Suppose, so what I'll do is I will irrigate. So if I'm treating the gingiva, so what I'll do is I'll irrigate the gingiva with a photosensitizer solution, photoactive dye. So the photoactive dyes are methylene blue and toluidine blue. Toluidine blue O. So these are the examples of photoactive dyes. So I will irrigate the gingiva with this dyes. So now what happens? So the photosensitizer gets attached to the tissues. So especially to the bacteria that are present in the tissues. So now when the laser light is falling onto this, now the photosensitive dye that is present, this gets excited. Okay, this gets activated. So now this will release oxygen, singlet oxygen, and it will release free radicals. These free radicals are harmful to bacteria. So now the bacteria get killed. So the laser light is falling onto the photostimulated dye, photosensitizer or the photoactive dye. Once this light is falling, this photosensitizer gets activated, it gets excited. So now it will react with the oxygen present in the tissues and it will get converted into singlet oxygen. So it is reacting with the oxygen present in the tissues. It will get converted into singlet oxygen, free radicals, and it will result in bacterial destruction. So how are we performing this? We are irrigating the area that we are treating with a photoactive dye. Later, we are passing the light. We are passing the laser light for 60 seconds. Now, all this process takes place and there is bacterial destruction. So this photosensitizer is interacting with the bacteria present in the tissues. Okay. Yeah. So next is low-level laser therapy. So low-level laser therapy. Here, we are using the wavelengths of light as red to infrared region. So the commonly used one is near infrared, red to near infrared region range are most commonly used in dentistry. Okay. So the main goal of this low level laser therapy is here we are using a wavelength of low range. That is only 600 to 1070 nanometer. Excuse me. Yeah. So we are using only a wavelength of low range and our goal is to reduce pain or to stimulate healing. Since we are using low range, low wavelength of laser, we are calling it as low level laser therapy. So what is the use of low level laser therapy? It promotes the wound healing by reducing the inflammation. It will reduce the inflammation. It will increase the healing. It will increase the formation of granulation tissue, proliferation of fibroblasts and formation of new blood vessels. That is a neovascularization, formation of new blood vessels. Okay. So we have seen photodynamic therapy and low level laser therapy. Now it's LENAP. Laser assisted new attachment procedure. Okay, so here for the purpose of attaining new attachment, we are using the laser. So laser, we are using laser for this purpose. So here, what we have to do is, I have given this step so that you can frame an answer from this. Okay. So for the purpose of use, for the steps included in this LENA part, first, you need to thoroughly perform the examination. You need to give anesthesia and you need to perform bone sounding. Anesthesia, bone sounding. What is bone sounding? So under anesthesia, when you place a probe and you will, once you place the probe till the bone level. Okay, so this is done in order to detect the osseous defects, in order to detect the bony architecture that is present. So this bone sounding is also called as transgingival probing. This is performed under anesthesia. After giving the anesthesia, you will place the probe deep till the bone level and you will study the bony architecture. So here you are knowing the pocket depth here. Okay, first you will perform the complete dental examination. You will give anesthesia, perform the bone sounding. Later, you are passing the laser in order to remove this pocket lining. So you're removing this pocket lining. Okay, so after removing the pocket lining, one more thing. So whenever you are passing it back and forth in order to remove the pocket lining, you will have that necrotic tissue that will get deposited onto this laser tip. So you need to wipe off this necrotic tissue, the debris that is present with a wet cloth. Again, you need to place it in the pot, place it inside the pocket. So it is usually stated that 1 minute should be used. I mean, 1 minute or hello. Yeah. So for every tooth, you need to use it for 1 minute. And this laser tip has to be passed back and forth in order to remove this pocket lining. Okay. So the end point, when will you know that you have removed the pocket lining? So the end point, we will know the end point when we will see no necrotic tissue on the laser tip. So when there is no necrotic tissue on the laser tip, it usually indicates that we have removed completely the pocket epithelium. Okay. So it will come with the experience also. Okay. Experience of the clinician. So after you remove this pocket lining, you need to remove the calculus that is present on the tooth surface. With the help of piezo scaler, you will be removing the calculus. Now later, a second pass with the laser is done. That means this is the first pass. That means first time you're passing the laser into the pocket in order to remove the pocket epithelium. Next, you will go with the second pass. Okay, so this second pass with the laser, you will finish the debridement of the pocket. You will completely debride it again. And later, you will compress the gingival tissue. So you have removed the pocket lining, right? So you will compress this tissue onto the root surface. Okay, so this will help. The second pass will help us in stabilizing the fibrin clot. So here you can see the red thing. So here there is stabilization of the fibrin clot. So now, after stabilization, you will splint the tooth and you will, if there is any trauma on the occlusal aspect, if there is any trauma from occlusion, you will remove that occlusal trauma. You will reduce that occlusal trauma in order to promote the healing. Okay. So now this is the laser assisted new attachment procedure. So here the laser is passed two times. This is the first pass. This is the second pass. You will be removing the pocket epithelium. Okay. Next. So what are the advantages of lasers? You have a dry surgical field. There is better visualization, isn't it? So while using laser, there is hemostasis. Okay. So there is stabilization of the clot. So there is dry surgical field and there is decreased swelling, edema, and decreased scarring. There is almost no scarring with the, when we use the laser. Okay. So there is decreased pain. Faster healing is seen when compared to the conventional surgical procedures. That is when we perform with the help of a blade. Next, there is increased patient acceptance also. Next, we'll see the application of lasers. So there are different applications. We can perform the phrenectomy, that is a removal of the aberrant frenum with the help of lasers. We can perform the gingivectomy and gingivoplasty. We can perform the de-epithelization of the reflected periodontal flap. So once we reflect the periodontal flaps, we can remove that pocket epithelium with the help of lasers. We can remove the granulation tissue. We can take the incisional and excisional biopsies of the benign and malignant lesions. We can irradiate the aphthous ulcers. So aphthous ulcers, which are chronic and huge, if they are irradiated with lasers, they will result in faster healing. Okay. And we can use it for the purpose of gingival depigmentation and also for the purpose of crown lengthening. Okay. So with this, we have finished the lasers. Now we'll go on to the third topic, that is a microsurgery. Okay, so micro surgery. Micro means under magnification, under microscope. Okay, so macro means with the help of unaided eye, naked eye. Okay, if you are visualizing directly with eye, it is called as macro surgery. So here we are using magnification. Micro surgery is the surgery performed under magnification of 10 times or more, 10x or more. Okay, so 10x or more is possible only with the help of a surgical microscope. So in this magnification, we can do it under two ways, with the help of loops or with the help of microscope. Okay, with the help of loops, we cannot achieve up to 10x, but with the help of microscope, we can achieve higher magnification. So what is the use of this microsurgery? Why are we using the microsurgery? This is to increase the visual acuity. So visual acuity is nothing but the ability to differentiate in between the objects. So when compared to the naked eye, when compared to the unaided eye, if we use magnification, it will improve the visual acuity. It will improve the improve the area that we are seeing. It will magnify and show us. It will increase more visual acuity. Okay, so that is the hallmark of magnification. So under magnification, there is improved visual acuity, and also there is improved manual dexterity. Once our visibility is getting improved, once everything is getting magnified, so obviously the techniques will get improved. The manual dexterity, the way in which we are performing the surgery, will also get improved. So the in case of periodontal surgeries, those are all the gingiva and all, they are fine tissues. Okay, so if suppose we are performing under magnification, we will have improved manual dexterity. So we will be able to appreciate our own surgical skills. There will be refinement of the surgical skills. Refinement of surgical skills. So there is something you need to understand about the microsurgery. This is called as microsurgical triad. In microsurgical triad, we have magnification. So there is improved magnification, there is illumination, and there is refined surgical skill. So how is this refined surgical skill being achieved? So under magnification, our visual acuity is getting increased. There is more illumination. Okay, and there is refined surgical skill with microsurgical instruments. So these microsurgical instruments are very small. So we have seen in the topic of instruments in periodontal surgery. So these microsurgical instruments are very small when compared to the conventional surgery. So with the help of magnification, with the help of small surgical instruments, and with the help of illumination. This illumination is achieved by fiber optic technology. Okay. So this will illuminate the area, okay, by focusing more amount of light onto the surgical area, specific areas wherever we need. So all these, the magnification, illumination, refined surgical skills will form the microsurgical triad. Okay, so with the help of using these small surgical instruments, we create less injury. There is diminished morbidity to the tissues. There is less trauma to the tissues, and there will be rapid healing. So we have seen these instruments right? So the blade breaker knife, lamella, 260 degree spoon, lamella, all these instruments, right? So these are very small when compared to the conventional instruments. See here, you can see the 15 number blade, whereas this is the instrument that is used in microsurgery. Okay.
Start preparing for the NEET MDS from your home. Dr. Pranab Academy of Dental Sciences. Online classes for all first, second, third, and final year students. NEET MDS online test series, unlimited practice and highest quality teaching. Affordable pricing. Download the app.
Here we can see the microsurgical instruments. So we have already seen in the topic of instruments in periodontal surgery, right? So the blade breaker knife, lamella, 260 degree spoon, all these, right? So here, because of the use of the small surgical instruments, there will be minimal injury, less injury, and there is diminished morbidity, less trauma to the tissues, and there is rapid healing. Okay, so here you can see the comparison in between the conventional instruments and the microsurgical instruments. So this is the conventional 50 number blade that we use, and this is the comparison with the microsurgical instrument. You can see how much difference there is that is present. Okay, so this is the conventional needle holder, whereas this is the microsurgical needle holder. So everything is very small, because of which our surgical skills get refined. So as I have already told you, there are two magnification systems. So in order to magnify, in order to perform the microsurgery, we can use either the microscope or we may use the loops. Okay, so in loops, we again have three types. Just remember this: simple, compound, and prism loops. Okay, So the problem with this is, with the loops, is the magnification, maximum magnification is only up to 5x. Okay. Whereas for the microscope, we can have a wider range of magnification. Okay. So what are the benefits of microsurgery? Improved aesthetics is seen. We have increased visibility of surgical site, isn't it? We are magnifying the area that we are treating. So we have increased visibility of surgical site. There is increased precision in the delivery of surgical skills, isn't it? So we are using finer instruments. Okay, so we are having a lot of magnification. We are having a lot of illumination. So the precision in the delivery of surgical skills is getting increased. And there is precise repositioning of the tissues with smaller needles and sutures. So the needles that we are using are also smaller. The sutures that we are using are also smaller. There are microsurgical sutures that we'll use. Okay, because of which the gap will be closed. Okay, so even the micro gap in between the tissues, we will be able to close it with the help of these microsurgical sutures. Okay, so minimal post-surgical discomfort is present. There is great patient acceptance, enhanced patient acceptance. So what are the drawbacks? It is technique sensitive. There is a learning curve, especially with the help of microscopes. Either the loops also, it is difficult to learn, but comparatively, microscopes, there is a learning curve that is present. Okay, there is a steep learning curve. It takes a longer time for the clinician to learn the microsurgery with the help of microscope when compared to the loops. It is very technique sensitive. Cost required to establish a microsurgical setup is also very high. There is restricted area of vision. So with the help of naked eye, when you are unaided, you will be viewing the whole area, right? Whole surgical area. But here with the help of microsurgery, there is restricted area of vision. Okay. So thank you.